We'll go ahead and get started. I want to welcome everybody to RCBI. I'm Jamie Cope. I'm the deputy director here, and saw a few folks that hadn't been here before. Happy to arrange for tours whenever we're done. It's always great to see what's going on at RCBI. We're really excited today to have Tim Bale with us. Tim is a local guy, grew up in Summersville, went to West Virginia Tech and received a electrical engineering degree there, and then a master's degree from Georgia Tech, and currently lives in Virginia Beach. So doing some great work with SIS, and since you're not here to see me, I'm just gonna let him go ahead and take it over. So thank you.
Hey, thanks for the introduction. Like you said, I'm here to talk about some of the work I do with autonomous systems. So just a little background about me. Like Jamie mentioned, I grew up down the road in Summersville, graduated from WVU Tech with an electrical engineering degree in 2007. And then I did a master's at Georgia Tech through their online program where I worked on machine learning and interactive intelligence. So I've been working with all sorts of autonomous systems for about 11 years now. I did 3 years here in Montgomery with a West Virginia-based company called Technology Solutions. The maritime part of our project was originally funded through Robert C. Byrd through a congressional, and that created a few jobs here. So we were here for 3 years, and then we moved our operations to Virginia Beach, combined with another SIS office out there. Also, a faculty member at Georgia Tech still. I work with their online master's program and teach a course in reinforcement learning and decision making. So just real brief topics. I was gonna talk about, you know, kind of autonomy, the company I work for, and some of the work we do, as well as, you know, challenges to this field and some of the future research that we're working on. So SIS, it was founded in 1997, focusing on research and development. So we have a lot of offices across the country, working some on robotics and some on product lifecycle management software. Most of the robotics and artificial intelligence takes place out of the Virginia Beach office. So autonomy, this is something a lot of people kind of wonder what this means. So it's, you know, autonomy is really the capacity to make an informed, uncoerced decision. So these autonomous systems are given a mission or goal, and they plan how to do that goal. They're not given like a strict set of, you know, you must follow these waypoints. It's kind of says, I want to go from point A to point B, and you figure out how to get there. The system does that all on its own. Or, you know, you tell some of the boats we have, you tell it to patrol this area and investigate anybody that comes in, and it just figures out the most efficient way to do that without being told, you know, follow this exact route. So at SIS, we've developed this autonomy system that does mission level autonomy. It also has sliding autonomy, where at any time an operator can switch over and take control, move the boat, you know, move the vessel around, and then switch back into autonomous and let it take over. You know, and we've also started in recent years multi-agent autonomy. So we have all these vehicles out there, and getting them to work together and talk to each other is a big thing. So that if you have a large patrol area for a boat, as an example, you can put three or four out there, and then they can efficiently break up, you know, I should patrol this sector, and, you know, what they should do. We try to keep this to where it's not platform specific. We've had this on, you know, boats, ground vehicles for the Army, UAVs, you know, aerial vehicles, and even some underwater submarines. And so, you know, part of what goes along with the autonomy is when you have a really good autonomy system, you also need a really good perception system so that the vehicle can see what the environment is. And so we have a really advanced perception system that goes with LIDAR, you know, different types of cameras, infrared cameras, radar, and kind of fuses all that together to make a clear world picture. So And a lot of the work we've done is in partnership with NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory. And so at the core of our autonomy software is this autonomy engine called Caracas. And this was originally built to go on the Mars rover. And so we've worked with JPL to take this core software and adapt it to these vehicles and use it. And so this slide's just some brief architecture. You know, there's behaviors, you know, how it gets to the perception and the world model and all the planning that goes along with it. So this gets into just some of the functions of the autonomy between the route planning and perception. It also shows here on the bottom, and you know, we started into this multi boat operations recently where they share their picture. So if one boat's really far away and it has a radar picture, they can share it together, and it, you know, enhances the overall world view. You also might have vehicles out there where we had an operation one time where we had a radar go down on a boat, but there was two other boats near it, and so they share their situational awareness, their perception picture, and so the boat that didn't have radar was actually able to see and avoid targets. And so, you know, that kind of stuff going forward, especially in autonomous vehicles, is going to be important. And then recently, even more recently, we've got into the boats not only sharing their perception, but talking to each other about, you know, what they're doing and what the other one's doing, and kind of dividing up tasks and doing it in the most efficient way possible. So this is just some slide of some of the modules that we have. So at the top is our, you know, overall autonomy system that runs all the vehicles. We also have a system called MAC-2, which is a multi-agent command and control station. So this is to allow one operator to be able to control a lot of autonomous vehicles at a time and kind of monitor their overall health. At the center of all this is RADS, which is our Reliable Asynchronous Data Distribution System. And so this is a really good way of allowing the vehicles to talk to each other. So when you get out in an environment, you know, you have bad communications and you can have comms loss and stuff. So this system helps them deal with that and be able to share information in a really efficient way. We've moved recently to having these handheld tablets for the command and control software versus somebody having to be behind a big computer screen. So we've actually had instances where somebody can control a boat right beside you. You'll have an autonomous boat driving right beside you and you're controlling it from another boat. And then a big thing when you have these autonomous systems is the health monitoring. So you have to make the boat smart enough to know when it has a problem. Any vehicle smart enough to know when it has a problem to either automatically correct that problem or alert somebody that, hey, I need my oil changed, or this sensor broke, or I'm having engine problems. And so that's where our autonomous health monitoring system goes in. So this system does some prognostics where it'll look at trends and say, hey, I think in, you know, 2 days this part's going to break because I'm seeing these weird readings. So it even gets into that. Then we have an entire simulation environment that does ground vehicles, water vehicles, aerial, and underwater, because, you know, stuff is expensive to test in the real world, and so we try to make a simulation environment that's, you know, as realistic as possible, so you can do, you know, 90% of the testing before you turn the vehicle loose in the world, so you have a high degree of confidence that it's going to work. And then we have some tracker systems that just, you know, they're an independent tracking system to know where these boats are at all times, even if they stop communicating for some reason. So, first I'll get into some of the boats we've worked on. So in the beginning, a lot of the work we did was on, you know, boats for the military. So these are some of the boats, you know, we've worked on a wide range. These are anywhere from 7 meters up to about 40, 50 feet. We've also worked on some 200 plus foot vessels. And we've even lately been down all the way to 3 foot and 8 foot boats. So it really, and it's the same system that runs it. It's just a different boat. You put in some different parameters. So. So, you know, we've really started demonstrating this stuff in about 2009. So this slide kind of shows, you know, kind of a history of where we started with, you know, a single boat using a cell phone modem for communication, doing some patrol. And then we started moving into, you know, two boats, doing different missions, all the way up to, you know, we had five boats that protected a larger boat that was traveling up a river. Five boats surrounded it, protected it. If anybody came near it, they went out to investigate and kind of shield that person away. And then we went into four boats that were protecting a harbor. So, you know, they had this area, and anybody that was trying to come into the harbor, they were to go out and warn them, you know, you can't come in, and protect the harbor as much as can. So, and then we've got into some other longer range missions lately. So as I mentioned, you know, perception's a big thing for us. You can have the smartest autonomy system in the world, but if it can't perceive its environment, it can't make the right decisions. So we've worked on a lot of sensors, from using commercial off-the-shelf radars and LIDARs to even some custom camera systems to detect objects. The camera systems not only can detect objects, but even do some classification of, to not only is there another boat or car in front of me, it's, you know, it's a sailboat or it's a tractor trailer. You know, we've gotten into some of that because there's different rules. You know, you don't want to, if a sailboat's under sail, you don't want to pass it. You want to give it, you know, plenty of space. So, and we use all these sensors together because you want a really nice layered approach. One sensor can have issues, like LIDARs do not do well in fog, cameras don't do well in fog environments or rain, but radars seem to perform well in those environments. So, just a quick overview on two big efforts we had, Swarm 1 and Swarm 2. I think the links to these videos were shared with the introduction to this presentation. So, Swarm 1, we had 13 USVs. Five of them were fully autonomous. The rest of them were remote controlled by humans from a distance. So they did offensive swarming, meaning they surrounded a high-value unit that it was supposed to escort up the river, and anytime somebody came near it, two or three of them would go out to investigate and keep that threat away. So that was all conducted in August of 2014. And then we built on that technology to do Swarm 2, which was just, it was four USVs doing defense cooperation. So we gave it an area, said protect this area if anybody comes in. We had one boat that had a camera system. That boat had the camera system. As soon as somebody came in the area, it was to go out, get cameras on it, you know, kind of identify it, classify it, and then another boat would hand off and trail it out of the area just to make sure that it didn't do anything that it wasn't supposed to. Recently, we started working on ground vehicles with the Army. So we currently have a project ongoing with TARDEC out of Michigan to put this system on some of their convoy operations so that their convoys can be smarter. If a vehicle drops out in the middle, they can kind of go around it and reform, because they want to use this technology to have these convoys do these long haul operations autonomously versus, you know, soldiers having to drive 12 and 13 hours. You know, these systems can do it without having any fatigue or any problems with that. So, and this same technology can be applied to commercial, you know, tractor trailer type operations as well. We've also started getting into aerial vehicles, so small quadcopters. We have a project with Northeastern University and a company called CTC where we're going to do swarms of these quadcopters to carry out kind of you know, cooperative missions like mapping an area or investigating threats. And, you know, again, this is the same software that's running on the boats and the vehicles runs on these. It's just slight modifications to control the vehicle. Because what we eventually want to get to is to where you have all of these systems working together. So you want to be able to have, you know, aerial vehicles, ground vehicles, and even boats and underwater working together to perform missions, to kind of, you know, help expand, you know, a big ship's reach, or even, you know, you even want self-driving cars on the road. You want them to be able to cooperate and know where each other's at and talk and make the right decisions versus just driving around by themselves. So I wanted to talk some about the challenges we run into working on autonomous vehicles. One of the big things we run into is what we call SWAP, which is size, weight, and power. So, you know, you have to have this computing equipment to do all this artificial intelligence and planning and perception and, you know, more recently, machine learning. You know, one of the big things with that is, you know, for machine learning and artificial intelligence, you need large computers that take a lot of power. But you can't really put that on a small, you know, UAV or a small boat or a small car. So being able to, you know, get that power down and use as little computational power as possible to allow it to be on these smaller vehicles. So, and you know, a lot of what helps us with that is the technology industry is really growing recently to shrink computers and make smaller computers that are even faster. And so this is kind of a progression of where we're at with our current system that's running on all the vehicles. You know, we started out with these large, what we called the Coke machine, which was a large case about this tall that had all these rack mounted servers in it. You know, weighed about 250 pounds and it took about 550 watts. So, you know, we were able to get down to smaller computers eventually that fit in this big Pelican case that, you know, we got it down to, it could run on 24 volt DC, because we really wanted to get into the DC, because not a lot of vehicles have, you know, household current. You want that, you'd be able to run off of battery voltage. And now we're down to these smaller iBrick computers. Pretty much everything can run on one of those right now. So, you know, we're down to about, you know, 13 to 15 watts of power. And then we've recently started working with these NVIDIA Jetson TX2 boards. So they're about the size of a credit card and can run most of the stuff we want to run on it. So we've really, you know, luckily the technology industry is helping us with this problem to shrink stuff down. So, another big thing is human trust, which is one of the reasons we like to kind of give these presentations and talk about our technology is, you know, as we get these self-driving cars and boats and everything out in the world, you know, you've got to have it to where people trust that the system's going to make the right direction. I mean, if you're sitting across the stoplight from a self-driving car, you want to make sure that it's not going to run into you, that it's going to turn or do whatever it's supposed to. And so we have a lot of that going on. You know, one example was, you know, a big, nice example is cruise control. I mean, it was first introduced in cars in the 1960s. You know, a lot of people use it now, but there's also a lot of people that don't use it. They still don't like it. They don't trust it. But just, you know, you've got to start educating people on this technology so that they can begin to trust it. Because a lot of people get kind of scared when they see a vehicle without anybody in it coming towards them or near them. So, yeah, some of the ways we're tackling the human trust problem is through nice visualization tools like this that allow you to kind of see what the boat's doing. So this yellow box right there is a contact that it's detected. The boat's down here in the bottom. And so you can see it's got this red section that says, I don't want to go in that direction because that's going to be a collision. And so it wants to steer towards the green. That way it can go around it safely. So through visualization tool and then education, like I mentioned earlier. So that's kind of for the water. So for ground vehicles, that use a lot of LiDAR and camera. We have some visualization tools like this that you actually can put boxes around. You know, this is a person on a bicycle, another car, and that way the operator that's monitoring this vehicle has a good sense that it actually sees that car and it's going to make a decision to go around it. So, and then, you know, education. So there's lots of simulators. These are some commercially available simulators for mining equipment and self-driving cars. This one here on the bottom is a picture from my office where I work at of he's got three boats running together right now. So kind of these simulation environments can help introduce people and get them comfortable without actually being on the in the real world interacting with them. So another big problem we run into is, you know, we live in a very noisy, dynamic environment, so stuff's always changing. You know, sensors are only so good. They're error prone due to a lot of environmental changes. They can lead to bad decisions. You know, even the best, well-trained, perfect AI agent can fail if you give it bad information. And so I like to always use the analogy of Mr. Magoo. I mean, you have somebody, something that's really smart, but it can't see 5 feet in front of its face, so it's going to make bad decisions. And you know, ways we're working to do that is through doing the multi-sensor fusion, like I talked about, having lots of different types of sensors coming together to make a clear picture. There's, you know, some smart data filtering we can do, and also auto-tuning to where if the camera system kind of determines that it's in a foggy environment, it can adjust some of the radar settings to make the radar perform better in that environment. The next thing is testing and training time for these and resources. So, we're starting to use a lot of machine learning algorithms, which require a lot of data to train. It's really expensive and really problematic to have a vehicle spend hundreds of hours driving around to, you know, learn what it needs to learn. You know, there's also, with these autonomous vehicles, there's limited number of test ranges. So, you know, some states are starting to come online to let self-driving cars go. With the boats, we have, you know, specially coordinated off test ranges that we have to use. UAVs, you have to go through the FAA to get approval to run them. So it can be really cumbersome sometimes and inhibitive to get these systems operational. So, you know, we're combating that problem. Like I said, there's lots more test ranges coming along. Lots of people are building, you know, UAV test ranges and self-driving car. You know, states are starting to allow self-driving cars on the roads. And then also through lots of simulations. So, you know, one example is this Carla simulation that, you know, you can see on the bottom. And I mean, it's, you know, pretty ultra-realistic of what, you know, a self-driving car environment would look like, and you can actually train your algorithms through there. We also have these types of simulators for the boats and the ground vehicles. All right, next I wanted to talk about some of the, you know, research that we're doing and the advancements that we're making in the field. So one of the first things is what we call smart sensors. So these are, you know, sensors that, like I was saying, not only can say, hey, there's something in front of me, but it's another car, or it's a sailboat, or it's a person walking, because you want to make different decisions based on what is in front of you versus just stopping. So a lot of these techniques come into what they call deep learning, to be able to take these images and feed them through a deep learning system that can then come out at the end and say, you know, with 94% confidence, I think that's a boat and not a car in front of me. And so we're starting to work towards this with all the, with all of our sensors to be able to classify these targets. And so we're working on artificial intelligence. I always like to say we're not building Skynet. You know, in order to get to that, it's going to take a long time to get to this general intelligence. So currently, all of our stuff is really rule-based. They're not really strict rules, but there's constraints on what decisions it can make. So we really want to get into machine learning. And so you have systems, and you need to go into what they call artificial general intelligence, which means an autonomous system that can work in all kinds of environments. So they have really advanced systems like AlphaGo that was in the news recently, that was a system DeepMind created that was able to beat the World Go Championship, the World Go champion in a game. But if you take that same system and you try to let it play checkers, it fails because it was specifically trained for one task. So we've got to work to have these algorithms that can do a wide range of tasks at all times, not just one specific thing. So for that, you know, a lot of that comes into machine learning. So having these algorithms that kind of mimic the way humans learn and are able to take large amount of data and learn relationships and, you know, proper decisions out of that without being, you know, explicitly programmed to make that decision. And so, you know, one branch of machine learning is called reinforcement learning, and that's a lot of the stuff that some of my personal research is and what I teach in. So it's a machine learning area that really is inspired by, you know, behavioral psychology. So it's, you know, it's how a child learns. So basically, you know, kind of at the bottom, and it shows you have this agent, which is your artificial intelligence algorithm. It interacts with its environment, and it makes an observation, and then it gets a reward, whether, you know, it did something correct or did something wrong. So much like a child, you know, you tell it not to touch the stove, but it touches the stove and it burns its hand. You know, he burns his hand and then he learns, I shouldn't do that again. So, you know, we're getting into this deep reinforcement learning that allows these agents to interact with their environments and learn what to do and what not to do. And simulation comes into play a lot with this. And so, yeah, so the algorithms look to, you know, mimic the way human learns. It continually learns. So a lot of machine learning algorithms, sometimes they learn for a long time and then they stop, and then you kind of let them go and make their decisions. Reinforcement learning constantly learns. So every time it makes a decision, it gets a reward and it learns whether that was a good decision or not. And so you'll see them slowly adapt over time to come to the optimal process. Like I said, this can be time and data intensive. So there's some things like imitation learning, which you can actually turn on the reinforcement learning algorithm while a person's driving the car, and it takes in all that data and learns while the person's driving the car. And then you can get to the point where you know it learns enough that you can turn it over to it. And so that kind of helps with the testing and the data as well. I think I have a couple videos. So this is some reinforcement learning algorithms applied to video games. So we've kind of, some of our algorithms start in there and then you move them out. And so I think some people may recognize this as Flappy Bird, which was a big game. And so, you know, when the movie starts, it's really having a hard time. It's failing, you know, miserably every time and running into stuff, but it keeps going, and it keeps going. You know, and every time it runs into something, it gets a negative reward saying you shouldn't have done that. And so if we go a little further into the video, you see it's starting to get a little better. Like it still hits sometimes, but every now and then it makes it through correctly. And so that's kind of how the reinforcement learning works, is, you know, as it interacts with the environment and does things, it starts learning the right decision. So it starts to learn that this gap through the pipe is where I need to go to get a point. And if I hit the pipe or hit the ground, then I lose points. And so you can see it's starting to get pretty good towards the end. So, but, you know, this agent was probably trained over, you know, 24 hours or something, running, you know, thousands and thousands of games. And then, so once we start getting kind of these environments, we move on to more complex things. So this is a game called Lunar Lander. And so the point of this game is to land to get the little lunar lander to land between the two stakes on the ground. And so you can see it just keeps crashing. It's coming in way too fast. It just keeps falling. But then every now and then it starts to get lucky and it starts to learn, hey, if I land here, I get some positive reward, and so it slowly starts getting better of knowing, hey, this is what I should do. And so these are the kind of, algorithms that will eventually kind of become the future of these autonomous systems, of being able to interact with the environment and learn, this is the right thing to do, this is the wrong thing to do. So some of the quick benefits and downfalls on machine learning. I mean, the benefits of these algorithms, they form these generalized behaviors that can be applied to a variety of tasks without, being specifically trained for one thing. They're also pretty good at adapting to noisy and changing environments just because of the way they interact and learn as they go. If the environment starts to change, they start to shift their behavior to adapt to that environment. The biggest problems with this is, it requires a large amount of computational power. So you need, lots of computers to run these algorithms. And then it also requires lots amount of data. So, I mean, the simple algorithms I showed here, take, 24 to 48 hours to train to where they start actually playing the game correctly. But, there's exponential growth that as in a self-driving car could take, 50 years to train or something. It's going to take a long time. So we have to get better about how we train these and how efficiently we can train them. So just a quick thing, if people are interested in this field and kind of, want to work in it as you go forward, big things that we look for are computer science, electrical engineering, and computer engineering. Most of it is software programming. So, software programming is a big skill to have. We do a lot of C++ and Python. We also look for people that can work really well about troubleshooting. So you're going to be in the, a lot of these times you're going to be in the field, you're going to see these vehicles working, and you're going to know, hey, this isn't quite working right, so I should adjust the algorithm or do something different. And you have to have really strong communication skills for a job like this, because we work in large teams across lots of companies. And then, if anybody's interested in, my company that I work for and opportunities there, feel free to talk to me. I mean, we're always looking for all levels of engineers as far as software, electrical, and computer. We also do lots of internships and co-ops throughout the year that college students can take advantage of.